My name is Lachelle Uzcategui-Gaymon. I'm 51 years old, and I live in Sydney, Australia. I was born in Newark, New Jersey, and my parents raised 7 children in Plainfield, New Jersey. I left the States in 1988. I was 26 years old. I have a twin sister, and I was born with club foot. It's a curvature of the foot, and at 2.5 months old, I was taken to, I believe, was Newark City Hospital. At that time, they advised my parents that they should break the foot and put a plaster cast on it. They did that, and from what my people tell me is they've taken me back to hospital twice and was sent home with aspirin. On the third occasion, my foot began to turn colors and was rushed back to hospital, and my parents were told then that my left leg needed to be amputated. So at 3 months of age, I lost my left limb, 3 inches below the knee. Quite harrowing for my parents, who at that time had myself, another 3-month-old, and it just began this, series of my necessity to be in hospital, have several operations. The thing that concerns me the most about it was my parents were poor, they were uneducated. They were in a system that I believe they weren't really being, sponsored by anyone with any kind of knowledge. So I spent 5 years in and out of hospital because as an infant, my bones were growing. So I'd go back into hospital and they'd have to cut the and chip away the bottom bone of the stump. I was relying on artificial legs from that moment on. I got my first prosthesis when I was 10 months old and got a new one every year up until I was 18. You know, at that time, my parents would have been on some form of medical coverage, Blue Cross Blue Shield, with their jobs. When I turned 18, I was then responsible for my own health care. Because it was a pre-existing injury, I wasn't able to get health care from my own work Blue Cross Blue Shield system. The other thing that I find really fascinating about the story is that my parents, it took 6 years for them to get any kind of compensation for the loss of my limb. The doctor was apparently a registered doctor. He wasn't registered, he was a physician that was going for his registration, living in Newark, but from Pennsylvania, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. My parents tell me that they were not allowed to sue this guy in New Jersey, but had to live in Philadelphia in order to carry out a suit to get compensation. It took 6 years for that to happen. So by the time I was, no, I believe 5 years, by the time I was 6 years old, my parents were compensated with $15,000. $15,000. I was fortunate to go to university because I fought for my right to be educated, and I went to William Patterson University for 4 years. When I graduated, I began a job with the Department of Office on the Handicap in Elizabeth, New Jersey, for state government. And even then, I remember not being able to get compensation or insurance because I was an amputee. So here I am, fresh out of university at 23 years old, 24 years old, and I couldn't get insured for my pre-existing injury. Which to this day, I do get fairly annoyed with that whole American system of disadvantage for people that are uneducated in legal matters. When I graduated and worked for a couple of years, I'd also worked as a camp counselor at a summer camp in New Jersey, upstate New York. And I met several people from all around the world. I decided in 88, I was gonna leave and go on a holiday and visit another country. And I found Australia because I'd done research. I had a friend here. I thought I'll come out and visit this country. What I did, when I came out, and I always tell people like this, that I came with a leg on my back because I had my prosthesis and I had a spare prosthesis that I had made before I left. And I brought that with me. within 3 years, and I needed a new prescription or a new prosthesis, I was introduced to an English doctor called David Millens in the hospital system here. I didn't know what the system here was like at the time, but what I quickly found out was that they had what's called a repatriation scheme. If you're a veteran of war or a person that has an amputation that has no previous compensation, you go right on to this scheme. So I was able to go to the hospital, the local hospital, go through the series of assessment and get prescribed a prosthesis, which was fantastic for me. So I found this new knowledge that I was able to actually get a leg, and I was able to keep myself mobile. That's the most important thing for me, is to keep myself mobile. So I'm here, 3 years, and I find this out, you know, the next time I need to go to the doctor about something, because I'm relatively healthy, and I have been, knock on wood, praise God, in all other areas other than my leg. I needed to go to the doctor for something and found out that I can go to a local doctor and use my Medicare card. And again, I don't have to pay for the service fee of seeing that doctor. So at this stage, I've been living in this country for 24 years. I've had probably prescribed about 6 or 7 prostheses. Each prosthesis I get cost me $200. $200. If I was still living in America with a pre-existing injury, the average for that prosthesis is going to be $7,000 or $8,000, which greatly disadvantages me against someone my age, my background, my education level, because I have a pre-existing injury. It still alarms me that my parents can be, and myself, be taken advantage of because, you know, I have to say they're not knowledgeable. And to be able to have me walk away from that situation with no compensation to match the needs of my limb. Now that I'm getting older, obviously as a result of the amputation, I have an issue with my right knee. I had to have cartilage removed because of overuse. And after overuse of, say, 38 years, again, I went to my doctor. I was able to book into a local hospital. They did the removal of the cartilage, which relieved me from 6 or 7 months of pain at the time. And it cost me nothing. You know, as I get older, I expect I may have hip problems. I may need to have a knee replacement on my good knee. Again, I'm in a position where I'm here in this country, and medically, I can't leave because I'm being looked after here. This is what I want for America. I believe that people need to stand up at this point and say, we have a right to healthcare. We have a right to be looked after. I don't understand how a nation that is so powerful and so strong don't look after its people. You look at Canada, you look at some other countries, I think the Netherlands, they have this healthcare system. And America needs to have it. I'm a walking property of someone who I believe deserved to be looked after, especially since I wasn't born an amputee. I became an amputee as a result of someone else's negligence. My parents were abused in that system, and then I further continued to be abused as I was growing up in America. And my blessing is that I'm in a country now that is looking after me because of an issue that happened there. And at some point, that needs to stop. I sacrificed the relationship that I have with my family. I sacrificed developing relationships further with my family. I sacrificed being able to spend time with them. I go home and I visit every 3 or 4 years. I went to a hospital in East Orange, New Jersey that I grew up at. It was a rehabilitation hospital where I had most of my needs met there as a child. And there was a person that was attached to that hospital who was a prosthetist. And I had, one of the screws had loosened in my limb, my prosthesis. And so, of course, I'm thinking, well, I've been there for all 18 years of my life. Let me go and see this guy, and maybe he can fix it because I'm over here on vacation. And I rocked up, spoke to him. He wanted to charge me some $350 to have a screw tightened. Now, again, I was quite upset with that because I thought, well, you know, my parents struggled. They went to every Lions Club, every Salvation Army, you know, any place they can go as I was growing up to ensure that I had a prosthesis, because they didn't have a bucket full of money to get this leg. What they had was they had that $15,000 that they set aside into a bank account for me so that I can have that when I get older. So when I was 18, they said, here's this little bit of money that we were giving to you. But the struggles that they had welfare and Social Security, all these people trying to get them to spend that money before they would give them assistance. And they refused to. That's the one thing that I can always be grateful for my parents, is that they wanted to make sure that I had something. So yes, I went and paid the $350 to, you know what, I learned after that. Now what I do is I carry a little screw with me. It's got a screwdriver, little container of oil, and I self-repair. Because when I'm on holidays, I don't have that extra money. Okay, if I was in a situation where I had that compensation, maybe I would have that money so that if anything went wrong, I always have it. Well, I guess what I'm saying in that story is that even when I go over there, I'm not looked after. If I go over there for a holiday, I get travel medical insurance because I want to make sure that I'm going to be looked after. I'm still an American citizen. I've got dual citizenship. So if I were able to go over there on a holiday and something happened, I want to fall into a healthcare system. I want to be able to say, okay, well, I can have my needs met while I'm there. Because as an American citizen, I have a right to that. And we all should have a right to that. So my sacrifice is that I have understood at this point in my life that this is where I'm going to be. And in that, I sacrifice developing family relationships, old friendships I don't have. My life is now set up here. And it has to be in order for me to look after me. Yeah, so sometimes when I'm on holidays, I always make sure I pack my WD-40. Because what happens is sometimes I just get, this is just a standard wrench, a screwdriver. These little nuts and bolts, they just come loose. So basically, I'm just tightening that up. A lot of times you get moisture in the side there and just squeeze a little bit of that. These components down here, I might get go to the beach or something and get a bit of water. And then that takes an Allen key, tighten that up a little bit. But it's taken me years to understand that I can actually fix these little things myself. And so that's what I do. I go on holidays, I make sure I pack these things with me so that I can look after this. I'm happy with that. Look, I'm an Obama fan. That's why I'm wearing the hat. But what I'm a fan of is I'm a fan of the Democrats and the pushing of this healthcare system. I mean, it's been in the making for probably 80 years, but the last 18 years, they've been pushing further and further and further. And yep, hitting a brick wall every time. But in order for us to be able to continue to push, we need to keep the Democrats there. Right now, Obama is the candidate. He's a candidate we need to get behind and we need to support. God forbid we get him in there and the Republicans continue to block. We only have 4 years to get this into place. If part of it's already started, that's a bonus. Now let's keep pushing the rest of it so that in the next 4 years, we have it in place, working in the hospitals, working in the medical centers. We have the pharmaceutical companies accepting it. We have the American people improving in their health. There's no reason that a nation like America can't have a system like this. At the end of the day, we're all being scared off by criticisms that say it won't work. Well, my personal opinion is I'm in a country where it's working. The system will be fairly similar, if not exactly the same. I get sick, I have a cold or flu or high fever. I go to my local doctor, I give her my Medicare card, I sign the document. She goes and she puts that document towards the state government and federal government health, whatever account it is, they pay for it. What I do is I pay at the end of my tax year a Medicare payment. So part of my taxation will go towards that pocket of money, that pool of money. And everybody pays it. So if you're earning a low income, you're not gonna pay as high as a person that's making a higher income, a middle class or an upper class person, because it's all based on the income that pops into that healthcare funded bucket. And that's the way it should be. So you're not gonna lose any money. What you're gonna gain is health. And we all need that, especially as we get older. And in a situation that I'm in, it's inevitable I'm going to have more problems. I'm not angry about the situation. I'm grateful that God's blessed me with knowledge, and the knowledge that I had is what my parents didn't have. Somehow the knowledge that came to me is that there's somewhere in the world that can look after me. And guess what? I'm here. What we can learn is to rid ourselves of the fear. There is no fear in a system that can help you in your health. There's no fear. But we need to get behind our local government, our council government, our presidential candidate, and stand as a people and say, this is what we want. Not for ourselves, but for our children and our children's children. We need to change the way the medical system in America is. And we've got to do it now. Running out of time.